Good morning. Welcome to Veterans for Peace, the TV show. My name is David Ross. I'm a graduate of South Burlington High School and the University of Vermont, majored in cultural anthropology. I was not drafted. I enlisted regular Army. I spent a year in Germany, learned German, got a car, put a Porsche engine in it, and found a little town full of mill girls that were all from Ireland, Wales, and Scotland, dying to meet someone that spoke English to date. So I was like a base local hero because I could get you a date and take you there in my hot rod Volkswagen. Had everything going for me. My friend and I, we volunteered to go to Vietnam. Nobody had heard of it. This is like 1965. Careful what you wish for. We went to Vietnam. I came back in coach. Ken Babb came home in baggage. He didn't make it. My buddy. So I saw things that no human should see in Vietnam, and that turned me against the entire concept of war. And more or less, I've been working to end war and to educate people about it pretty much ever since, about 50 years now. So introduce my co-host, David Ransom. He's a veteran of the Korean War.
Yeah, Korean War. I was pretty much a peace nick, peacemaker from youth. So very much less exciting than Dave's journey. And came up through the ranks and did my duty as a good boy scout. And at that time was called registered for the, volunteered for the draft. That was a way to shorten your assignment. When they went after me for officer's candidate school, I said, no way, I want that short assignment. And came through that as a radio operator, chaplain's assistant, assigned to a Nike battery and all these wonderful emerging nuclear weapons we have that we would love to get rid of. And after that, went into ministry, spent time as a pastor, counselor, chaplain, and retired from that back in 1998. Speaking of which, retirement kind of leads us to our guest today, Dave, Wendy Coe.
Wendy, would you like to introduce yourself and give us a little bit of background? Tell us, like, how did you get interested in the peace and justice issue?
So I'm one of the founders of the what is now the Peace and Justice Center, which the organization started at a meeting on January 28th, 1979, here in Burlington. And but before that, how I got interested, I was brought up a Unitarian Universalist, and which are known for being very left-wing type people, to put it in one word. I grew up out in the countryside outside of New Haven, Connecticut, and in my junior or senior year at the University of Vermont, my parents were moved to Louisiana for my father's job, and I didn't want to go there. I had no place to go to where we lived. And so I stayed in Burlington, and my sort of touchstone community was the Unitarian Universalist Society, because it was something I was used to, and also because I was a self-employed seamstress. So I would go there and cut out my patterns on the big tables in the sort of kitchen area. It was very convenient. Yeah. And I was one of the few young people. The congregation was going through a transition, and anyway, there were very few young people. And I forget how it exactly happened, but I started reading all of the sort of social responsibility committee literature that came in from Planetary Citizens and Oxfam and Greenpeace. I don't think the UU's got the Catholic Worker.
Okay. I always liked that one.
Well, yeah, most of the people in the congregation were not Christian, so I don't think that they sent it to us, but anyway. I just started reading that. So I guess I would say I was self-educated, and also I also became a member of what is now City Market. Onion River Co-op back then was just a pre-order. This would have been in the mid-70s, and mid to later 70s. And so I started meeting other young people, and I found a group of people that was Burlington Safe Energy Coalition that were protesting nuclear power plants. And generally speaking, nationwide, the anti-nuclear power movement led to the anti-nuclear weapons movement. And that's sort of what that meeting was in January of 1979. This guy, Terry Provance, came from a national organization called Mobilization for Survival and talked about nuclear weapons and obviously what a horrible thing it was. So me and a few other people, Howard Stearns and Dan Henley and Will Miller are all dead now, but Dave Conrad was there and Amy Demarest, and there was a few of us, and I said, I can find us a meeting space at the UU because I actually had a key to get in there. But anyway, so we met there originally, and our very first action that we did, which was sort of a march and followed by a film, happened to coincide. We did get one little picture in the free press, but it coincided with the weekend that Three Mile Island melted down. So we were a little bit overshadowed, but it also pointed out the dangers of the nuclear industry. And I did go away to cook for a UU summer camp in Massachusetts that summer, and I came back, and it was like people had stopped meeting, and I said, no, we have to do this. And so Robin Lloyd joined at that point, so about 6 months later into the organization, which was the Burlington Peace Coalition. And she and I, and we sort of started gathering other people too, but she would have these great creative ideas of things to do, whether it was a street theater or a protest or a speaker or a film or whatever. And I knew I had skills at organizing because I had been part of a youth group where I either cooked for 100 or 200 people or I managed the money. I started managing money at a very young age. So I was doing that, and Robin and Lloyd and myself and Greg Guman, Gene Bergman, Anthony O'Combe, Scott McGinnis, these people aren't around anymore, but we all started doing a variety of things, and so you get to 1983, and Robin really thought that there should be a Peace and Justice Center, a resource center for the activist groups, because at that time there was also a lot of Central America, anti-Contra activity, CISPIS. Mm-hmm. There was, of course, now I'm not going to remember them, but maybe I'll think of them. Anyway, that it would be great if we had a place that could be a resource, because this is before computers. This is before the internet. So the idea was to have a library and have a place where people can come together and share information. And so she set up a what is now called a pop-up store in the old Ben and Jerry's gas station for just 2 months, November and December. We had a profit of about $4,000. That was our nest egg. And that winter, we sort of had meetings with all the other reps from all the other groups. And we went down to Albany and looked at, they had a setup that was sort of a coalition. Actually, when you went into their space, they had 10 desks, because each group had a desk. It was a very long, narrow space. And in the back, sort of a living room situation where they could all sort of meet together. And we took a copy of their bylaws. And anyway, we came back. And in July of 1984, we hired Mark Estrin as the first coordinator, is what we called the director then. And we just rented this room at 186 College Street, and he realized nobody's coming through here. And so there was a space right below, which they called it the mezzanine in the building, but at 186 College Street, and had two little rooms and a bigger room. And he said, we've got to start the store again and have like used books and used clothing. And we always had, you know, piece paraphernalia, bumper stickers and buttons and t-shirts. And that sort of did get some people coming in. Plus, we then had a room big enough for this coalition to exist. And also in 1982, so a few years before that, when it was just a few of us, a smaller group, the original grassroots group, we had gotten nonprofit status, and so we just sort of, that coalition became the board of the Berlin Peace Coalition, and then eventually changed our name to Peace and Justice Coalition and the Peace and Justice Center. But back before we had the Peace and Justice Center, we did some amazing things, and I guess my 15 minutes of fame was for June 12th, 1982. This is a an old bus poster from then, and it it was basically we sold bus tickets for $30 a ticket round trip to go to New York City to participate in what turned out to be a million people in New York protesting nuclear weapons. And from Burlington alone, we had six buses and six vans. The bus company knew me well. And probably, I don't know, 20 years later when I was calling the bus company about getting a bus to like the Women's March or maybe something before then, there was this guy who still remembered me. And anyway, it was really sort of funny. And
that's great.
There were people like in Brattleboro who said, oh yeah, we've called them and reserved a bus. I said, you need to put money down. They cannot find any more buses. They're like going over to Pennsylvania and up into Canada, and they can't find any more buses to rent. And that's why we had six vans. And it was just really exciting. I had called up UVM and said, can we use your big parking lot up by the water tower? And this guy said, sure. And then about, I think it was like maybe 1 or 2 days before this actual day, this woman calls me up and said, who gave you permission to do that? And I had the name written down, and I said, oh, yeah, he no longer works here. And the thing is, I had been on Channel 3 News. It was like publicized everywhere. And they were like, she was sort of caught, like, was she really going to tell me that we couldn't leave from there?
Wow.
When somebody who had worked there had said, anyway, they let us meet there. And so we left at night, and so somehow in New York they heard about us. Well, it might have had to do with the fact that they had organized the parade so that Bread and Puppet was going to be like, I don't know, one of the top three events or pieces of the parade at the very beginning, and New England was going to be at the end. And I said, you can't do that. I have a lot of Vermonters who are going to be with Bread and Puppet, and you just can't separate the families. We have to be like right behind Bread and Puppet. And I still don't know how it happened exactly, but the Village Voice, which is probably like our 7 Days newspaper, or maybe it's even was more of a real newspaper. Not that 7 Days isn't real. I don't know. Anyway, they actually sent this woman named Jan. They flew her up to Burlington to ride our buses down because it was like all these Vermonters coming down. What is going on up there? And so she wrote an article in the Village Voice, and she said I was the ultimate contact person. In the article, in the paragraph about me, she capitalized it. So that's when I say it was my 15 minutes of fame. But anyway, we all got down there, and luckily all of our vehicles were parked in this warehouse district, and we had to take the subway. Some of us had never been on a subway before. Mm-hmm. And I had parents calling me up, and I said, we're all going to be together. And Frank Teagle, who was this retired printer in Woodstock, had printed 177 towns. Well, because in 1981, I'm mixing up my stories here, the Burlington Peace Coalition had organized, at that point there were 17 towns that, or 18 towns that voted for a nuclear weapons freeze. And then in 1982, it amounted to 177 towns. So he made this white poster with green ink on it, and then he, you know, with a blank for the town saying voted for nuclear weapons freeze, and he hand wrote in every single town. Oh. So that the photographs from there just show an ocean of Vermont signs.
Yeah.
And the police loved it because they said somebody would be lost, and rather than just some anti-nuke sign, it was like the Vermont anti-nuke sign, and they could find it. There's a Vermonter, because they were holding a sign that said Vermont. And that taught me that in the future, we should always somehow put Vermont on our signs, so that it wasn't just yet another one. It was like people knew where we were coming from. Mm-hmm. And it was.
And who you are, very exciting. For our state, we're working.
Yes, and they told us that we had. I mean, the organizers said that Vermont had the highest per capita representation, because we probably had even over 2,000 people down there. Because I knew about the people who were carpooling or getting there in whatever way, but we had a huge number of people down there. And then the following year, we had sort of an anniversary. Rally in South Park here in Burlington, and Leslie Kagan, who was one of the organizers, came up and said, Wendy Coe was right. Vermont belonged at the head of the contingent there because you guys, I don't know, she was being nice to us. You guys were awesome,
right.
Or whatever. Yeah. So, and we did all of this without the internet.
Yeah.
You know, there was no cell phones. It was all word of mouth or mailings. We had our newsletter back then were just mimeographed sheets. It was just amazing what we accomplished without having the internet. And so that also speaks to the fact that at the very beginning, our organization was about anti-nuclear weapons. Mm. But we also got involved in the Central America issues. We got involved with, Hiroshima and Nagasaki, I guess, comes under anti-nuclear thing. Yeah. But even to this day, we still do an event on that day to remember that horrible occurrence.
Sure do.
And we, there was this, sort of another fond memory I have. There was this woman who wrote a play. She lived over on the other side of the state, I think in Sharon, called Button, Button, Who's Got the Button? A Dream of Nuclear War. And wow. We performed in what is now where along Cherry Street those hotels are, the Hotel Vermont and the Marriott. I mean, that used to be sort of little rolling grass with some bushes and things like that. And that was our stage. And I don't know how many people we had to find. I mean, there were dozens and dozens of people. We had to teach some people to be able to walk on 3-foot stilts. We had people got into these cardboard tanks. We got people to fly bread and puppet-like doves. And so we... and I don't even know how we got permission to use that space. I mean, it's just back in the days when the insurance companies didn't run the world so much.
Yeah, right.
But it was, I mean, Steve Conant, who also around that time was just starting Conant Custom Brass, he was helping with making of the stilts, and his wife, who taught art at the high school for ages, made the face masks that we needed. And Jim Geyer also helped with making the stilts because his carpentry shop, you know, he makes rocking chairs. But oh, he was the one who really had the original inspiration to have the town meeting resolution about a nuclear freeze. From listening to Helen Caldicott speak one fall.
Oh.
And he really didn't know about the Burlington Peace Coalition, but what happened there was Robin went and handed her a rose, and so he went up and asked her who she was afterward and found out about our organization. So with him and our organization, that's how we did the nuclear weapons freeze. But that also, 1981, in March, we got a lot of people out to vote because we could vote for something like that. I mean, who ever heard of voting for a nuclear weapons freeze at town meeting day? That was just like, it wasn't just school budgets and whatever. But Bernie Sanders was running for mayor for the first time then. We brought out a lot of liberal, more radical kind of people. So who knows what would have happened to Bernie if we didn't have the nuclear freeze.
I call him more centered.
Yes, okay. But we that was a real pivotal moment in history. I think that things would have been different if we hadn't done that organizing. Mm. And so I think that we really had a big effect there. I mean, people do say that, and my husband, the historian who isn't here, could really explain how Reagan's mind was changed about nuclear weapons, and that because we made such a big hullabaloo about it, and it spread, you know, across the country.
He finally understood that a nuclear war would be bad for business.
Anyway, so through all that time, I was doing the bookkeeping. I was a lot more involved in the actual sort of program work, if you will. I mean, doing things, making sure that we, you know, had whatever supplies we needed, or making phone calls. And all the while, I was just a self-employed seamstress, sewing for people. So I had a very flexible schedule, if you will. So I had the ability to do that. And I was also writing in the UU newsletter, the weekly newsletter. I would write, "Dear Planetary Citizen," and then I would, you know, from something that I was reading about, I would do this little paragraph to try and educate other people about stuff. So it sort of really kind of snowballed from there, I guess. I mean, because I don't really think of one particular thing that got me going, but anyway, I continued to do that, and then when we opened the center, I continued doing the bookkeeping. Somebody donated an IBM computer, because he worked at IBM. So I started learning about computers and on DOS. I mean, in some ways, my whole evolution over the 41 years was followed the development of the computer. You know, going from WordStar to WordPerfect to Word and Lotus 1-2-3 and all those things. And the newsletter went from being mimeographed to Quad Left Graphics offering to donate the layout of the newsletter. But back in that day, when I would type in an article, at the beginning and end of each paragraph, I had to put a code in to tell it to indent or to skip down. I mean, it was like not just as simple as it is now.
Yeah.
It was, but I love.
You just type it out and send a printer.
Yeah, well, I, so I'm just a very detail-oriented person, so I loved doing all that detail work, so it was a lot of fun. I'm not really a writer, but I would take everybody's articles and figure out where they could fit in. And when they stopped doing it, then I had to learn PageMaker and all the, like PageMaker 1, 2, 3, 4, and after I think 6 or 7, then it became InDesign. So I evolved technologically over the decades too. And so I was doing more behind the scenes, but I was working with so many creative people. And it was such a joy to be able to be the infrastructure behind their vision to really help enable their great ideas to happen. Mm-hmm. That was a skill that I had. So it was, so my life changed and my role changed, but except that I did keep doing the newsletter. But I didn't work on programs so much, except that, Wendy, we need a bus to New York, we need a bus to DC, we need a bus to Boston or whatever. And I knew how to do that detailed organizing because you're like keeping track of everybody's who's paid, who hasn't, mm-hmm. all yeah. that little detail-y stuff. And then I love making a map. And of course, then people don't. Actually, so I would still even, in the past few years, make a paper map handout for people, because when you get that many cell phones down in DC, they didn't work because it was like a traffic jam of cell signals.
So you just have so many towers.
Well, so people were glad that they at least had a piece of paper that at least, you know, with basic street names and where the subway stops were and what time they had to get on the subway, because we figured out with the bus company, rather than them driving down and getting stuck with everybody else, we always went to the end of the Orange Line, and there was a hotel right there for the buses. They would drop people off, go to sleep, and then, and it meant like a 30 or 40 minute subway ride for people, but it meant it was a lot faster getting out because they got right on the highway there. So we were just always very organized about that. And so that was also one of my roles, was doing the bus stuff.
Logistics.
Yeah, logistics. Yeah, that's exactly.
Put all the things in place to make it happen, anticipate the glitches so they don't happen.
Right, and also just trying to do everything as frugally as possible. You know, I always kept my eye out for coupons for buying paper cheaper for the copier and all that stuff. I always did the nitty-gritty kind of thing.
We're doing the most important work in the world, at least we like to think, and we're doing it on the least possible amount of funds available anywhere.
Right. So the thing about the Peace and Justice Center is it runs on donations. I mean, we might get a few grants, but it would be a fraction of our budget. And donations is really, I mean, the store is sort of a break-even operation, and it is a program in and of itself. Mm-hmm. It obviously educates people about fair trade long before it was popular. In fact, Alice Christian, around 1990-91, when she was the store manager for about 6 years, she went to a national conference, I think it was over in Oregon, of fair trade when it was just getting going, and she came back, and she was a computer person, but she created the first database for the national fair trade movement. So our little organization, which isn't part of any others because people have asked us that, also had a very important piece there. And the store, you know, it was about economic justice, it was about racial justice, because we are probably helping I mean, most of our sources are predominantly people of color and poor people, and we...
A lot to do with the third world.
Yes, and yeah, global south, I think, is the terminology that is used now. And, so we really wanted those stories to be spread and to empower those people. But the idea, if you... We actually got our nonprofit status as an educational organization. Yeah. And so if you educate people, then hopefully they will make a morally just decision, whether they're shopping or whether they're signing a petition or making a donation. I mean, there are other organizations that we've seen around us that say, you should believe this, you should do this,
yeah,
blah, blah, blah. And we're going, here's the information, you're a human being, we believe that you will probably figure this out in the same way we did. And what can I say? Agree with us, hopefully.
Wendy, is it at the point now, or is that still developing, where you've gathered so many people who are really informed? And I think so many times David here and his experience, and you have probably hundreds of people. And so do the educational...
Hopefully
thousands. So do the educational organizations, to the schools, to the colleges, to
they are actually paying us now to come and do the workshops, so our workshops are actually predominantly racial justice oriented, and our racial justice work sort of started in the early 90s. Ellen Kaler was our executive director for 12 years, and she is the one who really took the organization in leaps and bounds to a whole new place from just being a little grassroots organization, because she started the Racial Justice and Equity Project. Our first hired person was Richard Wright, but he left after a couple of years, but John Tucker stuck with us for several years. He was a vet. He passed away about 10 years ago now, but learned a lot about racial justice and white supremacy and from him, just working with him, being with him, hanging out with him was quite the education. Watching him work and watching him put on different hats and different accents, and he was a real great activist, and then we always kept doing peace work, and so then we had the Economic Justice Project and the Racial Justice and Equity Project, so we called it the Peace and Human Rights Project because we were doing this work and we had other titles, so we did that, because especially when the Iraq War came, a lot of peace work came out of that too. Probably one of our other really biggest impacts that the organization had was the Vermont Job Gap Study. We hired Doug Hoffer, who's now the state auditor, to write it. And he worked with Ellen and worked with M.M. Mulvaney Stanek and Colin Robinson, and Jen Matthews was the very first one, though. And really taught the legislature. I mean, basically, there was all this information about what it really cost to live in Vermont, whether it was urban or rural, and whether you were a single person, two-income family, you know, all these different variations. And we presented it to the legislature, and they said, what? We have to figure this out for ourselves. So they had their own little committee over the summer, and they did it, and they basically found that we were right.
They validated you.
Yeah, and then... and
guess what?
And actually, the funny thing is, when we just wanted to start that, when Ellen really wanted to do this, because I think it was Madison and maybe Eugene, Oregon. These cities had done it before, but not a whole state. And this was a time when we actually really did get a big grant. And I'm forgetting the organization. But so they, I don't know if they turned us down first, and Ellen called up and said, and had a big, long conversation. And she said, it sounds to me like you don't really believe that we can do this. Would you be willing to send somebody here and give me a couple of days to try and prove it?
I love it.
And they did. They sent this guy, and she proved it to him, and they gave us this grant for 2 or 3 years. And so we hired Doug, and we wrote this thing. And also in that timeline, trying to think of when these things happened. Emma, I think, was the staff person at the time who we got them to increase the minimum wage and to put it into law that every 2 years there would be a COLA increase. And that was the Peace and Justice Center doing that. So so anyway, our organization has done some really great things. And then 2008 came along. The economic downturn meant that people had less money to donate. So we had to, we had like 11 full-time people, let alone all the volunteers, let alone all the interns and volunteers and everything.
And you're sort of overseeing and coordinating and moving us around to make all these things happen.
Well, no, I'm paying the bills.
Okay. Nothing happened.
And thanking people for making donations and making sure we have paper for the copier and that we have, you know, big sheets of paper and magic marker for people to do their workshops and and getting it into the newsletter, because at that time we were doing the newsletter like 11, well, we went down to 10 times a year. So I was bugging people, get me your article, because we have to go to press, let people know what we're doing. I mean, in the middle of that time, when Ellen was there, we, because she left in 2002, mm-hmm. we got email. I mean, this was like a new thing.
Sure.
So, anyway, we, that's, so I was participating in a way in terms of, trying to make sure people had what they needed and helping to get the word out.
A vision for action.
Yep. Yeah. And then, so 2008 came and the money shrunk and...
we don't want to call it depression, do we?
It was depressing.
It was depressing.
And so we moved, we also moved from the basement where we were 21 Church Street for 18 years. Ellen did get us to move into a bigger place, which was good because it was a rabbit warren down there. I mean, people saw the store and they might have seen the library, but it just kept going back. And
this was Church Street?
Church Street.
Church Street.
But also, the handicap lift never really worked, so we weren't handicap accessible. The people didn't know about the mold in the back, and it you know, there were issues there. But we just kept doing our peace and justice work. And then we had a new, an executive director, Nancy Lynch, who was having a conversation with Melinda Moulton, and she was able to talk her to lower the rent, and Melinda very nicely did that. And so we moved down to 60 Lake Street, and the rent was basically the same. We just had like about 25 or 30% of the space. We had a much smaller space, but that was fine because we had a much smaller staff. We had to shrink very quickly, unfortunately. And so we're not doing sort of the vast array of things that we used to do. And there is now, because you also had the development the Vermont Worker Center, which was doing much more of the economic justice work. Uh-huh. But they were under our wing at first.
Uh-huh.
I mean, this is like 20 years ago, maybe even 25 years ago. They were basically, all the money went through us. You know, they were PJC employees, according to the IRS, and they basically got their stuff together and took off, got their own 501c3 status, and but we basically incubated them in a way that so that they could sort of get strong enough, because mm-hmm. they were trying to do it by themselves and they kept having issues. But then Ellen said, come under us for a couple of years so you don't have to worry about infrastructure so much, and you can get your activism part going, your educational and activism stuff. So that happened, and then it took off and became when they were strong enough to do that. Which actually leads me to the fact that we incubated a lot of organizations. I mean, we still, one of our programs is still the Allied Group Program. Groups who want to be these, do this activist work, but it's not really worth it to them to get their own 501c3 status, because that's very involved and costs a certain amount of money. And then once you have it, you have to keep track of your money exactly. And when you have a group of volunteers, they don't necessarily have the skill set or want to do that or whatever. So I was doing their bookkeeping all those years, and that was part of my job too. So I did do that too, which meant I had contact with all these different groups, and that was kind of fun to feel like you're sort of, I don't know, a mother hen incubating mm-hmm. these groups,
sure.
just sort of helping them do their thing and paying their bills. And
Wendy, what are some of those babies' names?
Okay, well, actually, if I can think, there was a MEAN, Middle East Action Network. There was I guess Burlington Portica Gabasis, they were their own group, but they rented an office from us down in that Church Street location.
Mm-hmm.
The Hydro Quebec group was sort of a separate group, but I don't even remember what their name was, but oh dear. Mm-hmm. But anyway, we had four drawer file cabinets filled with all the Hydro-Quebec activism stuff, which is actually at the UVM Vermont Library Archives, as is all the livable wage stuff. We had, I mean, Vets for Peace was sort of one, but you had your, you were part of a national organization, so we didn't do your bookkeeping or anything.
Yeah.
But the
lots more.
There were a lot of groups. I mean, it's terrible right now. I know that there's a Freedom and Unity Chorus, which is like the newest one, yeah. Which is a group of people, like I think she has about 60 people or so, learning activist songs, and huh. they're like for hire. They'll come and sing in protests and stuff like that. It's
wow.
a really cool idea.
Yeah.
The Vermonters for Justice in Palestine is
yeah.
a group. The Stop the F-35.
Yeah.
How could I forget them? They're like one of the bigger ones. There was
Sisters way back in the day.
Oh yeah. Way back in the day, yeah.
We were there. We lived through that, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So that has been something in terms of that sort of still gives you the feel of a coalition. Because
uh-huh.
what happened was you had the coalition and you had a representative from each group. I mean, this is back in the 80s.
Uh-huh.
But the thing is, all those people were trying to fundraise for their each individual group, so
yeah.
that when Ellen came on in 1990, she saw this predicament.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, how do you get these people to do fundraising for
yeah.
this resource center that everybody is sharing when they're trying to do their own thing?
Yeah.
And so that's why by 1995, we changed and became the Peace and Justice Center, which is a place rather than a group of people, if you will, a group of organizations. And we switched to make the board a more traditional nonprofit board, in that they were there for the center and do fundraising for the center.
Yep.
And and that, I mean, it just made a lot of sense because we were growing and we therefore needed more money and needed the focus to be on that that big thing.
Sure.
So, but so I think that, I'm sorry I can't remember a lot of the group's name.
Oh, that's all right.
But I can remember the people a lot more. But so another program that we also did, I'll call it a program, is having internships.
So, yes.
I mean, because I do want to get in here the fact that I just turned 67, but I am so glad young people, it isn't just an old folks movement kind of thing or a place. In fact, a lot of the staff are 20-something or in their early 30s. But having interns who care about peace and justice or volunteers, we definitely run on volunteers. It's really important that we have a large volunteer base. But I always, I mean, I don't really have a whole lot of interaction with the interns, but I always said to them, I'm so glad to see you, because I'm going to be dead soon, and, you know, we haven't brought peace and justice to the world, so we need you to keep going.
That's it.
And we need young people to understand that they need to take up
the banner. We fall on the battlefield. We need people to pick up the banner and march forward.
Right.
So until we finally get to a point where we can save our planet from ourselves and our pollution.
Yeah. But I'm really happy that the young person I handed it over to, Willow, really understands technology and software and things like that, and is a numbers person like I am, and is into detail like I am. So I'm so happy. And she said, is it okay if I keep asking questions? I said, listen, this was a baby of mine. I want it to succeed.
Yep.
I want you to be able to do everything so I don't have to do anything anymore.
No crib deaths in my organization.
And
climate. You did a lot of stuff with the climate change, too.
Not really, because our thing was to not do things that other people were doing.
Oh, gosh.
You had 350 Vermont, so we don't need to reinvent the wheel.
Yep.
And Extinction Rebellion also.
Extinction Rebellion,
I'm not familiar with that. That's a local organization?
It's younger people. They're getting started now. It's younger people, and they're all about disrupting. They basically.
And there's a Burlington group?
Worldwide.
Oh, that's worldwide.
Burlington,
okay.
Middlebury, worldwide.
No. So we were we did not try to be a national organization. We were a Vermont organization. We believed in educating individuals. We sort of believed in the growth factor, the trickle up factor, or whatever.
Right. Yep.
It's also part of the not telling people what to believe. The idea was that we can't handle the nation, we can deal with Vermont. And so we do still network with other Vermont groups, but
I think the national leaders learned something from that there's a trickle up.
I don't know. I think the grants, the foundations don't seem to know that. They seem to rather fund national groups rather than local groups. And that, maybe 15 years ago or something, there was an article in The Nation that actually said something to that effect, which was very annoying. But
well, it's hard to bring up any child, you know, Wendy.
So
on the top, there are children.
But it showed that, I mean, by existing on individuals' donations, that people want us to be there.
Yep.
In 2011, it was like we almost stopped, but we had a meeting, and people said, nope, you're still worthwhile, so we kept going. I want to also bring up that one of the people that I worked on the newsletter with was Ed Everett, who was a member of your Vets for Peace. And
He was our first secretary they didn't want any officers. And I said, well, you know, in order to register with the state and the feds and so on, you have to have a president, you have to have a secretary. And
yeah.
Ed was sitting on my left at that point. He just kind of whispered to everybody and in my ear, well, you know, I can take notes.
Right.
This
so
was it.
Ed would proofread the newsletter before it went to the printer.
Yep.
And then it would go to the printer and come back. And then he would present me a couple days later a copy all marked up with the mistakes that we didn't get.
And
he did that all the time. He was really into detail too. And he used to sort of sit in the library, was just next to my office. This was on Church Street. And he would sing these really old songs from the 20s or 30s. They're probably old drinking songs or something.
Yeah.
And it was wonderful. But I mean, the guy was a walking, talking activist and encyclopedia. And what he did in his life for peace and justice was just amazing. And we named an award after him. It's the Ed Everett's Peace and Social Justice Award. And this year, I'm actually one of the honorees. We tend to try and do an individual and an organization. And the event is on March 19th. And maybe Jeffrey could zoom in on this. And it's going to be at the Echo Center on March 19th. You can get tickets at the Peace and Justice Center. And so besides honoring me, the organization this year is the Vermont Coalition for Ethnic and Social Equity in Schools, which is a really important new organization, because we need to teach our children well. We need to teach them about these things early on so they grow up to be good people. Learning it just later on.
It starts with truth, doesn't it?
Yes, and it's funny, my son, who's now 33, he used to hang out with John Tucker a bit, and there was a Martin Luther King event at the Boys and Girls Club. When he was in high school, he said, I should not have to learn about this stuff outside of school. I should be learning this stuff in school.
In school.
And
John
was so excited when he said that. But so I'm really happy that this organization, that is their goal, is to have kids learn about this early on. And
a lot of it they should be learning in the kindergarten. And some, you know, like Montessori schools and others are way ahead of us in that score. Public education needs to really step up to the plate.
Yeah, so I am
and the colleges, the colleges should be way ahead.
Right. Well, I'm gonna be visiting with my month-old grandson, and I will be still raising my vegetables after 35 years in my organic community garden plot. I actually am the coordinator of that. And
you got it.
And I also encourage people to go out and vote with their information, because I am a ward clerk. So it's not
Wendy?
In Ward 2. So I'm still got a lot of things to keep me busy in my retirement.
Yeah.
I don't know, is there anything else? I just want to say I hope people keep supporting the Peace and Justice Center.
We do too. I mean, we haven't taken funds directly from the Peace and Justice Center, but we've coordinated things with them, and you know, it's a treasure. It's like a major resource, not just for the Burlington Chittenden County area, but for the state of Vermont. You want to find out what groups you might be able to work with, something that appeals to you. You want to find out what date things are scheduled for. It's all in the Peace and Justice newsletter.
The calendar is really online.
Oh, it's online. Online, yes.
I know. Everything is online now.
But so many things that have happened in Vermont, good things, they've happened because they came through the doors of the Peace and Justice Center. Peace and Justice might not have come up with each one of these ideas. People come in with ideas, and like something in a garden, Peace and Justice Center will help grow a group until it's really ready to stand on its feet. It's a lot involved, and I know because I've organized groups. There's a lot involved in organizing a group and funding it and getting it out in front of the public and doing things like television, writing, publishing, bringing in experts to speak to the public.
Well, it's like
so
we
much
have
of
a,
this is
we have
facilitated
a media,
through you guys.
Yeah, we have a media list. So like the Vermont Women's March, that had, what, 20,000 people in Montpelier a couple years ago. I mean, we have the media lists all set. So it's sort of like, because they actually are one of our groups. You write your press release, and we can instantly broadcast it. You don't have to reinvent the wheel. There's a lot of things that we already have figured out how to do, and so that groups know that they can come to us and do the stuff that we know how to do.
Well, it's the spirit you have there, too, Wendy. It's truth and compassion and caring.
And hope.
And caring takes details.
Right.
And well, persistence.
And persistence.
Because nothing worth accomplishing is ever done easily. Always involves setbacks, individual differences that have to be worked out. It's sort of like the ultimate babysitting job. Just giving birth, helping to give birth to new things, and then watching them take on a life of their own.
It doesn't all have to be negative, depressing about this stuff. We need to celebrate our successes and even just celebrate hope that we can affect change.
Well, you're a socially responsible doula.
We had a demonstration in Washington over the ability of us to, you know, control the hours of the Vietnam Veterans Memorial. Anyway, three different times a bunch of us were there and got arrested. It was a big hassle, but, you know, one of the police said, how come you guys are having such a good time? You're going to jail. You're just going to burn on your record. And we're all just laughing. We're singing nice, quiet, peaceful songs.
Yeah.
And I said, you guys are going to go to jail. So anybody, one of these guys gets upset, you're going to get your head busted. And how can you be happy? Well, you know, how can we not be happy? We are America. We are we are celebrating what this country is supposed to be, and we got the guts to do it.
Yeah.
And you should be joining us.
This is what democracy is like, right?
Exactly.
Yeah, peace is patriotic.
This poor woman, Hispanic woman, she says, sir, I need you to go stand over there. And I said, what's over there? Nothing over there. I just need you to go stand over there. Anyway, it turned out she'd been in Iran, not in Iran, she'd been in Iraq and Afghanistan. She'd been in combat. And she's just sort of almost in a crisis. She says, I don't want to arrest you. I don't think I can do it. I said, you're married? Yeah, you got kids? Yeah. I said, well, you just arrest me and go home. And I said, there is going to become a time when maybe you're going to have to make a choice between the people and the people who actually, the power people who kind of run and manipulate and do all the crap that you know is going on. Some point, you're going to have to make a choice. He says, we talk with each other. A lot of us have already made that choice. When it comes, we'll be with you. Well, I tell people, make the police your friends, make the military your friends, because if it ever comes down to the bottom line, they're the people you're going to need to win. So, and you can have a lot of joy doing this, singing your songs, reaching out to people, and you'll take criticism. What are you, commie, traitor?
Well, yeah, we're American.
Let's talk about it. Why do you feel that way? Get people involved. Don't tell people to go to hell. Get them involved in a conversation. Get in dialogue with them. Well, maybe I am a jerk, but, you know, I like to think I'm a nice guy. What do you see jerky about me? Let them tell you. And then say, oh, that's too bad. I think you're kind of cool. And just totally blow them out of the water, and then maybe you can have a real conversation, and maybe you can change people's thinking.
Yeah.
It's this whole thing around, if you're just depressed and upset all the time, you're not going to be able to stay with it.
Nope, people can go out and do something, even if it's just starting off by volunteering at the Peace and Justice Center and store, because you will learn stuff there.
Oh, yes.
And
walk in the door and you're learning.
Yeah.
Been said that God works in mysterious ways, and one of those ways is when you become educated and you start to understand the reality going on in the world out there, you want something inside you, you just want to help change it. So we're going to wrap up our show. We're so glad to have Wendy Coe, all the work that she's done and the work that the Peace and Justice Center is doing and continues to do. And thank you for being here. I look forward to going to the dinner and continuing to work and interface with the Peace and Justice Center. And, you know, it's a good group to donate to because they are, as you mentioned, very frugal, and it costs money to do these things. So until the next program, thanks for being with us, and you have a great rest of the weekend. Bye.